The belief that we belong on the cutting edge of innovation, that's an idea as old as America itself. It's in our DNA. We know that what these young people are doing, this is what's going to make a difference in this country over the long haul.
I created a nanoparticle that's kind of like the Swiss Army knife of cancer treatment.
A UV light lunchbox that kills bacteria off fruits and food.
My project was I actually built a detection method for buried landmines.
I did my project on sheep genetics and Cotswold sheep, the natural color versus the white genes.
The smartphone works with a Bluetooth-enabled heart rate monitor to detect if there's a medical emergency and then notify contacts with where you are, what happened, what's going on, where they can find you.
We created an adaptive hand device for a girl in Georgia.
So did you play the game or you designed the game?
I designed the game.
You designed the game. Sheesh. Yeah, that's pretty impressive.
So current cancer treatments, there are two major problems. First, it's not specific towards cancer cells, so it kills normal cells in addition to cancer cells. So that has very low patient quality of life. And then the second problem is that although it kills the majority of cancer cells, it doesn't really kill the source of cancer cells. So my nanoparticle can detect cancer cells in the body, eradicate the cancer cells, and then monitor the treatment response. The objective of this project really was just to personalize cancer treatment to make it more effective and how it can overcome a problem that all of society is facing.
Well, we're very proud of you.
Thank you.
Go cure cancer.
Thank you.
Yeah, I like that.
First of all, I have cousins who live in Mozambique and have to deal with the daily threat of landmines. I heard their stories and was really inspired by what they had to say. So while all this was running through my head, I was at the piano one night playing the piano, and I noticed that when I played certain chords or notes, the strings on a nearby banjo would resonate. And so I heard that and made the connection and thought, maybe I can use the same principle to detect buried landmines. So I started doing this kind of research and somehow ended up at the White House.
So this has just a very direct application to the sheep that are on your farm.
Yes, sir.
Fantastic.
There's only 2,500 registered Cotswolds in the United States, and that includes white and natural colored. Over the years, the people in the Cotswold industry have bred out the natural colors because the fiber artists want just the white wool to dye and use for different things. But now that people have realized there's such a decline in the numbers of natural colors, they're really trying to breed them back and pull them back into the industry. But it's really, really hard to get those high quality natural colored sheep because the genetic gene pool is so low. When you go to look for natural color sheep, it's really difficult to find them. And it's been my passion to breed and bring the natural colors back into the industry. I wanted to be in the fiber industry and have livestock and have the sheep so that I could learn more for myself about the animals in the livestock industry and just take part in that core agriculture process.
I did not realize that ultraviolet light can actually kill bacteria.
Yes.
I did not realize that. Well, that's a pretty spiffy invention.
First, you put the fruit in. Then you close the lid.
You turn it on.
You wait for 10 seconds. After those 10 seconds, you open the lunchbox. You simply take your fruit out and you eat it. A lunchbox that helps people. I never thought I could do that.
The ultimate goal was to help Danielle to write with her preferred hand.
She is right hand dominant, and she didn't have most of the fingers on her right hand. And she really wanted to write with her right hand, so we decided that we would help her write.
I know something about living with a limb difference because I have one myself. So we began to make prototypes for how to help her hold a pencil. And we ended up using a simple design of a platform and a cylinder adjacent to it, in which you could insert a pencil, and it just strapped onto her hand, and then she started to write.
The first thing we want to show you is, usually the user can check your status by clicking on the status button, and you can see I'm a little nervous, so my heart rate's a little high. We do have a series of checks to ensure that there are no false alarms, and let's say you do not press the check because you actually are in need of help. It starts issuing a loud audible alert as well.
As you'll see in a moment.
It's saying a medical emergency has been detected. The next thing that happens is a text message is automatically sent to her cell phone, and at the same time, your medical information is displayed on the screen, so paramedics and anyone else that shows up can see your past history and things like that, which could be helpful in the event of emergency.
One of the huge advantages of ours is that you don't actually need to press a button to summon help, you know, because when you need help the most is when you can't get it yourself.
The most unique thing about it is it is mobile. You can take it anywhere. This is on your cell phone, which is something most people carry around all the time. So I think that's an awesome feature. And also, as Ada mentioned, the fact that it's passive. You don't actually have to press the button. In the event of a heart attack, it will automatically send alerts to your contacts.
This is an idea that really resonated with all of us. We all have relatives that aren't living with us, in the house, who are far away. I know my grandfather had a stroke and in the backyard, and we didn't know exactly what was going on, for a while, and I always kind of wondered, what if we'd been able to, find him sooner or whatever. And so this is just to kind of, give them that security of having, family members when they need them.
In this game, I want people to be environmental, pretty much.
What the game is about, it's there's polluting factories in the city, mm-hmm. and the other people can't breathe. Mm-hmm. So this one right here has to pretty much go around and collect like coins and hearts and get their score to 500 so they can win the game and people can breathe better.
That's really cool, though.
Thanks.
How long did it take you to design it?
A couple months.
Uh-huh. So you want to be a game designer?
Maybe.
Yeah? Yeah, you're only fifth grade. You don't have to make up your mind now.
It's young people like you that make me so confident that America's best days are still to come. When you work and study and excel at what you're doing in math and science, when you compete in something like this, you're not just trying to win a prize today. You're getting America in shape to win the future.
What I would say to people, especially girls, who are interested in STEM activities, is that you should be.
Find other people who have similar interests, and I think working in a team helps a lot. Like, you can bounce ideas off of each other. You're not on your own.
Just go out there and go for it and do it. I mean, there are infinite possibilities. You can do anything you want. Just being a woman doesn't hold you back from anything.
So I feel like I can make a difference and develop technology that's really going to help people.
As a kid, I asked a lot of why questions, and I found that science and math usually were the answers, the coolest answers to all of my why questions.
By knowing that your ideas might change the future, it's something that I like.
I mean, it's a great field for everybody, and there's nothing that should hold women back or put men in front of us.
Don't give up on the first thing that doesn't work out. Keep going, keep trying until you succeed. And after you succeed, keep going and keep going.
Don't be shy. Try your hardest to do what you can do, because sometimes if you try hard enough, you can make it come true.